Friday, April the 10th, 2020. My name is Randy Cantrell. Thanks for clicking play. Let's talk briefly about heaven. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 1 through 4. It is doubtless not profitable for me to boast. I will come to visions and revelations of the Lord. I know a man in Christ who 14 years ago, whether in the body I do not know, whether out of the body I do not know, God knows, such a one was caught up in the third heaven. And I know such a man, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know, God knows, how he was caught up into paradise and heard inexpressible words, which it is not lawful for a man to utter. I just have one simple but powerful objective today as we continue to endure this COVID-19 crisis, and that is to help us concentrate briefly on our goal to reach heaven. Daily we are in busy pursuit of things in this life, albeit now that our lives are disrupted, our pursuits look very different, I suspect. And these things, these earthly things that we pursue, most of them are perfectly permissible according to God, and yet they are things that do nothing to help us take a closer aim at reaching heaven. I was a little boy at a big gospel meeting when I first heard preachers from Mexico attend, and they spoke at that meeting. I had never before heard a man preach with a translator, and I was fascinated by this. It may have been the first time that I recall hearing the adults talk about how the gospel was having a powerful impact in places where life was difficult. And at some point, I heard preachers remark how anxious, impoverished people were to go to a place far, far better than where they live. And I'm supposing there's something to that. I'm supposing that this current crisis is perhaps making us long for a place where there is no sickness and no sadness, a place like heaven. As I grew older and began to study the scriptures in earnest, it became clear that in Old Testament times, the people would draw closer to God during tough times, and they would drift further away from God in good times. Seems to be our tendency as well, to lean on God when we need his help, like now, and to forget about him when times are good. It's understandable, although it's not right, that we lose sight of heaven when life here is so good. So today I hope to spark within us the desire to make thinking about heaven more habitual in our lives, to have some better understanding that no matter how great things are here, once they improve, the Lord willing they will, that heaven is still a remarkably better place. So much better that even the people who were able to see heaven don't have any words, have no words to express it in human language. The Apostle Paul didn't know what state he was in when, by revelation, he was caught up into the third heaven, as he says. The Jews reckoned that the air above us, that's the first heaven. The firmament, what we call space, is the second heaven, and where God dwells, that's the third heaven. Paul experienced this 14 years earlier, which would have been sometime after he was let down in that basket in Damascus, which is how 2 Corinthians 11 ends. Verses 30 through 33. If I must boast, I will boast in the things which concern my infirmity. The God of our Father, of our Lord Jesus Christ, who is blessed forever, knows that I am not lying. In Damascus, the governor, under Artaz, the king, was guarding the city of Damascus with a garrison desiring to arrest me. But I was let down in a basket through a window in the wall and escaped from his hands. Some have argued that Paul's thorn in the flesh prompted his sharing what he saw. Well, the Holy Spirit prompted it, but it's sandwiched between these last verses of chapter 11 about his escaping Damascus in this basket let down by a wall and his admission about the thorn that he endured. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 7 through 10. And lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations, a thorn in the flesh was given to me, a messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I be exalted above measure. Concerning this thing, I pleaded with the Lord three times that it might depart from me. And he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. My strength is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, most gladly will I rather boast in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in needs, in persecutions, in distresses, for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong. There's a connection between what Paul suffered and his experience in seeing heaven, and sandwiched between his recall of running for his life from Damascus and his prayer that this thorn in the flesh be removed are the verses that I just read. And the amazing thing is that the Spirit gave only 10 Greek words to capture the entire experience. But Paul gives us two reasons for the brevity. One, what he saw and heard cannot be expressed in words. And number two, it's not lawful to utter, even if he were to have the words. Quite simply, heaven is beyond our ability to comprehend, but the word of God that helps navigate us there is not. Now, it appears that Paul may have had two separate experiences. He mentions the third heaven, and he mentions paradise. If, as the Jews viewed things, the third heaven is where God dwells, then paradise is that place where the Lord went after the crucifixion, but before he ascended back to the Father. In Luke chapter 23, verse 43, Jesus told the forgiven thief, "This day you'll be with me in paradise." It doesn't matter because we're only told what's revealed. Fully understanding this isn't possible because it seems God has purposefully left it vague, shrouding in mystery. He has told us what we need to know. He has told us the things necessary so we can secure salvation. Deuteronomy chapter 29, verse 29, "The secret things belong to our Lord, our God, but those things which are revealed belong to us and to our children forever, that we may do all the words of this law." We're not left to speculate about the existence of God, the existence of Satan, heaven or hell. God and Satan are real persons. Heaven and hell are real places. John chapter 14, verses 1 through 4, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may also be. And where I go, you know, and the way you know." The Revelation chapter 12, verses 7 and 8. "And war broke out in heaven. Michael and his angels fought with the dragon and his angels fought, but they did not prevail, nor was a place found for them in heaven any longer. So the great dragon was cast out, that serpent of old, called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him." Mankind has always been interested in knowing what heaven is going to be like. What Paul saw and what John saw are merely glimpses to teach us things that can help us live more faithfully here. They're not comprehensive, and sometimes they even prompt us to wonder even more. Lazarus didn't reveal anything about the realm beyond this life. We have the Bible, and that's all we need. We don't need people to return back to this earth to tell us more. And Paul said, it's not even lawful. As Abraham told the rich man in torment, who wished that he could return to warn his brothers about the reality of torment, in Luke chapter 16, verse 29, Abraham said to him, "They have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them." Much like the miracles performed by the Lord, God has seen fit to provide us with enough knowledge to be saved. John chapter 20, verses 30 and 31, "And truly Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these things are written, that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name." 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3, "As his divine power hath given us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us by glory and virtue." Scriptures reveal some important truths about heaven that we can know based on what we are told by the Holy Spirit. Heaven isn't just some state of mind. It is a literal place. In the Revelation, John described heaven as a great city. The language is figurative, depicting heaven the best way possible to give us an idea, given the limitations that we have with human language. But even the words given to John through inspiration are extraordinary. We try to understand that however great it's described, John, through inspiration, was woefully inadequate in human vocabulary to really share and depict the true glory of the place. The city is walled with 12 gates of pearl and jasper and precious stones. The streets are like crystal, pure gold. The foundation was made up of more precious stones. There is no night, no darkness, no evil. The river of life flows through the city, with the tree of life growing on both banks of the river. The leaves of it are intended for the healing of the nations. The city was 1,500 miles in every direction, and there were millions of people singing and praising God. And while these depictions aren't literal, let me offer you some literal comparisons to give us kind of a figurative picture. New York City is the largest city in the world based on land area, about 321 square miles. Not even close to the scope and the scale of heaven at 1,500 miles in every direction. It's a figurative number describing heaven. In other words, we can't fathom the size of the place. Currently, gold is about $1,663 an ounce. There are 16 ounces in a pound. A yard of concrete is 4,056.34 ounces. 1 yard of pure gold would be 6,745,693. Now, heaven has no need or no interest in money, but if we were to build just 1 mile of road to our current interstate highway standards, we would need 21,000 cubic yards of concrete. That would require $141.7 trillion. In other words, we can't comprehend the glory of a city whose streets are so precious. There are just two examples of the grandeur of heaven compared to things that we might could relate to here: those streets of gold and the mere size. But the most important things are those things that are much further beyond our comprehension. The Revelation chapter 21, verse 4, "And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away." It's beyond our imagination. A life where there's no reason to cry, there's no death, there's no sorrow, there's no worry, there's no pain. This current pandemic, there's nothing like that to ever be experienced again. No worry, no anxiety. Unless we're kids, we can't likely remember a single day without some degree of worry. And our days, especially now, are filled with sorrow and sadness and fretfulness and uncertainty. And while in this life, the Lord was described in Isaiah 53, verse 3, as a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, well, such is the plight we all have here. Pain and suffering are widespread in the world. They're reasonably widespread just among our families. According to the Institute of Medicine of the National Academics, there are about 100 million Americans who suffer every day with chronic pain. That's approaching a full third of our country's population. And that's just how pain in this life works. And it's not just chronic pain, but there's also the vast millions who occasionally or even frequently have pain. And that's just physical pain. Pile on top of that the mental and the emotional pain that everybody experiences, some vastly more than others. When my son was just a small boy, I remember him telling me one day while we were out driving how he wanted a stress-free life when he was grown up. And we happened to be driving past a graveyard, and I pointed to that graveyard and I said, "Right out there, those are the only people who have a stress-free life, because life in this realm is stressful." Luke chapter 16, verse 9, "And I say to you, make friends for yourselves by unrighteous mammon, that when you fail, they may receive you into everlasting home." The things in this realm are going to fail. Most of the barometers of achievement and success in this life, they are going to fail. Now, that doesn't mean in this life, but in eternity. All of the stuff all of the stuff that we have is going to burn up in the final destruction. It's interesting, been listening to some local radio, particularly talk sports radio. And it's interesting, with sports being gone, as you well imagine, radio hosts are finding other things to talk about. And they've been talking lately about the things that this COVID-19 crisis is teaching them. And they almost universally have agreed that what they're learning is they've got too much stuff. Their life had gotten too complicated. They are now sequestered at home, and they are now getting in touch with just simple, basic stuff, and they're liking it. All of the bank accounts, the investments, the rainy day funds, they're going to be obliterated. All the accolades and the fame and the fortune, they're all going to be destroyed. The things that go beyond this life are eternal. The deeds we've done, the life we've lived, good or bad. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 10, "For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive the things done in the body according to what he hath done, whether good or bad." Your actions will follow you into eternity, nothing else. And that's why our choices are so important. On the flip side, the things that plague us here, those are also going to fail. I mean, all the temptations, all the sources of evil, all of the sources of pain and sadness and suffering, they're all going to be in hell. Heaven has never been exposed to these things. Heaven will never be exposed to these things. The things in heaven will be things that make it so special and so joyful. According to those verses that I read at the beginning, here are some of the things that we're going to see when we arrive. The throne of God. The universe isn't operating on autopilot or on some random energy, as some physicist might believe. God is on the throne. God is in command. We're going to see that in heaven. The Lamb of God is also there. The Savior, who made our arrival to heaven even possible, he'll be there. The Savior through whom we've prayed during our earthly life. The Savior to whom we've sung countless hymns of praise. The Savior who died to purchase the church, which was our vehicle to get to heaven. He'll be there. Our hope is there. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 19, "This hope we have as an anchor for the soul, both sure and steadfast, and which enters the presence behind the veil." When we arrive at heaven, our hope is going to be realized. Heaven is a city of eternal hope realized. Our reward, our treasure, our inheritance, they're in heaven. And we can't be distracted thinking that they are in this life. And it's difficult. But maybe more so because we don't think enough about heaven. And maybe more so because, frankly, prior to this pandemic, many of us weren't thinking about God. We weren't thinking about life beyond this life. We are prone to not take our eyes off of this life's rewards and treasures and ambitions. If somebody asked you to invest $1,000 in something that would give you pleasure for a week, or you could invest that $1,000 in something that would give you pleasure for a decade, there would be no temptation to aim for pleasure for a week. And we would think that anybody who would choose that first option, they would be an idiot. But sometimes we're idiots because we invest our lives in things that will not survive beyond our lifespan here on earth. And meanwhile, we're tempted to ignore all the things that will travel into eternity with us. It's idiotic. It's nearsighted. And we all fight it. Peter described that condition when he emphasized that if we neglect to add heavenly graces to our life that God commands, then we suffer that exact same condition. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 9, "For he who lacks these things is short-sighted, even to blindness, and has forgotten that he was cleansed from his old sins." Sadly, blind and nearsighted Christians won't be able to see heaven either. The reward, the treasure, the inheritance is going to escape them. Matthew chapter 6, verse 20, the Lord said, "But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. Matthew chapter 5, verse 12, "Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you." 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 and 4, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to the living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you." Now, we're citizens in America, and it's great. We believe that we live in the greatest, freest country in the world. In fact, perhaps the greatest and freest that the world has ever seen. And as great as it is, it's not everlasting. Our U.S. citizenship is not going to exist in heaven. We can't carry that with us. It will earn us no special privileges. And whatever benefits we get from it pale in comparison to where our true citizenship is, in heaven. Philippians chapter 3, verses 20 and 21, "For our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body, that it may be conformed to his glorious body, according to the working by which he is able even to subdue all things to himself." Our names are there too. You know, people love to see their name in a good light. People go to great lengths to get Twitter and Instagram and Facebook likes. We enjoy people following us. But there is no place where our name matters more than having our name recorded in heaven. Think of all the lists that you have looked at in your life, hoping to see your name. Do you remember how anxious and hopeful you were? It might have been some childhood sports team. It may have been an honor roll. These are meaningless things compared to heaven. How can we work as hard to make sure our names are in heaven as we do to make sure our names are on some other important list? Well, by doing what we do to obey God, by thinking more about heaven, by thinking less about unimportant earthly things, by refocusing our life, or perhaps for you, by focusing for the first time on what you can do to please God. Luke chapter 10, verse 20, "Nevertheless, do not rejoice in this, that the spirits are subject to you, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven." Our faithful loved ones, our Christian faithful loved ones who have passed on, will be in heaven. All the faithful throughout history are going to be there. King David had a very sad life in many ways. And one of the saddest moments of his life was his penalty for sin that he was forgiven of, but he had committed adultery with another man's wife, and they had a child. And the little baby boy died. And King David knew that his dead little baby boy would be in heaven. And he knew the only way that he was ever going to be able to see this child again would be to live faithfully to God so that he could go there too. 2 Samuel chapter 12, verse 23, "But now he is dead. Why should I fast?" asked King David. "Can I bring him back again? I shall go to him, but he shall not return to me." We sometimes sing hymns about a reunion in heaven and about how grand that will be. According to Isaiah chapter 60, all nations will come to God's light. So when John writes that the nations will be there, he means the nation of all the faithful, no matter where they lived on the planet. God's presence makes heaven glorious. Faithful people populate heaven, and that makes it all the more precious. To share eternity with a throng of the faithful is blessing beyond our imagination. You know, sometimes those of us in the faith, we attend some large gospel meetings where Christians from all around the country and various parts of the country surround us. We spend our time singing and praising God, worshiping God, enjoying each other's association. And then it's over. We go back home to our daily lives. We go back home to our congregations. But for those few days, our focus and our attention are on spiritual things with brethren. And it's a wonderful distraction from the pressures of this life. Imagine being surrounded by the faithful forever, never again having to endure the pressures or the friendships with unbelievers, never again worrying about the temptations to measure up what unbelievers may want from us, just being in the company of the redeemed, where everybody we encounter has put and is putting God first in their life. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9, "But as it is written, eye has not seen nor ear heard, nor have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who love him." It's a reference to Isaiah chapter 64, verse 4. So as you daydream of accomplishments, as you daydream of achievements, as you daydream about what life beyond this current crisis might look like, you are able to imagine those things in great detail if you put in the effort. I mean, even if an Elon Musk, and you're like him, you can have dreams that, well, they go beyond this planet, out into space, and maybe you want to achieve things as he does, things that have never been achieved. Your imagination is going to enable you to consider what it may be like. But that's not how it is with heaven. God is preparing a place for those who love him that is beyond anything we have ever considered, beyond anything we are even capable of considering. It is bigger, it is grander, it is more wonderful than our capacity to imagine. And we have a big capacity to imagine. Now we can wonder, we can dream, but the urgent matter at hand is for us to love God enough that we obey him, because that's the only way to get there. Jesus said in John chapter 14, verse 15, "If you love me, keep my commandments." That's how we're going to reach a place that God is preparing, this magnificent place that, well, even Hollywood with special effects couldn't make up. What we can imagine is missing is because we've neglected to put our attention in this life where it belonged. Imagine standing at judgment to find out that you devoted your life to nothing worthwhile, nothing that would benefit you when this life is over, to discover that you could have and you should have made a very different choice where you could enjoy heaven forever, only to find out that you missed it because you loved yourself and you loved this world more than you love serving God. We can and should imagine that so that it creates within us enough fear and enough reverence for God that we are compelled to obey. Let me leave you with three verses. And I would ask that you do yourself a favor, that you read these every day for the next week or so. Set aside a little bit of time when you do and reflect on how terrific life might be for you in heaven, and see if it doesn't fuel more and more in you to put in the godly work here. Make note of the verses. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 16 through 18. "For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, and with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words."